Allowing. That's when he can manifest his power in your life. I said 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians verse 9, 12 and 9. 12 and 9. Let me say this before, because I'm going to start at 9, but I'm just going to run through this real quick, the top part of it. But what this dealing with, Brother David, that Apostle Paul had got a revelation from God, okay? What is revelation? Revelation is revealed knowledge that comes from the Spirit. And Paul said, because of the abundance of revelation, he said, I received a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me. You know, he said, unless I be exalted above measure. So here's the Apostle Paul, one of the greatest apostles, that said, he said, the only reason I'm going through what I'm going through is because I got a revelation from God. And we talked about this last week. Whenever you get a revelation or a revealed knowledge from God, how do you know that the enemy is coming? When you really start understanding your purpose, understanding your destiny, that's when the enemy comes. Mark 4 said, when the word is sown, that the enemy comes immediately to steal the word that is sown in your heart. So when God give you revelation, when God give you a word, the enemy is saying, Brother David, I'm not going to let you keep it. I'm going to bring some pressure. I'm going to bring some problems to steal that word that has been sown in your heart, so that word won't produce. So it's the same way with the Apostle Paul. That when he got the revelation of, he said he received abundance of revelation. So when he got the abundance of revelation, then a messenger of Satan, a demon, a spirit, somebody that's influenced by the devil, was sent to buffet him. The word buffet in the Greek means to strike. To hit. That means whatever Paul was going through, amen, it was hurting. It was pain. But the reason he received it was because of the abundance of revelation that he received from God. How many of y'all holler here, Jesus, use me? Lord, I want to know you more. Lord, give me more. Now, I ain't prophesying over you. But I am telling you this, that when you ask for more of God, then Satan is coming. Because he don't want you to walk in that word. He don't want that word to produce fruit, to produce righteousness, to produce love. Amen. To cause the covenant to become alive in your life. Think about it. The Bible said Abraham was rich in cattle and in land. He was a wealthy man. He was blessed. And the Bible said in Galatians 3, amen, that if we're Christ, then are we that seed of Abraham? So all them blessings are yours. And remember, the enemy is coming to stop you. He's coming to steal the word that is sown in your heart. So don't be surprised. People church, oh God, I thought everything was going to be all right. It is all right. God's just making you. He's molding you. You know, that people always say, Lord, mold me. I want to be more like Jesus. And they don't know what they're asking for. And I'm not telling you not to ask for it. But what I'm telling you is this, that when you ask for it, know that the devil is coming. You want a healing ministry? He coming. You want a deliverance ministry? He coming. You want a teaching ministry? You want a preaching ministry? Oh, he coming. But because as soon as God started revealing, let me tell y'all this. I didn't realize this myself for a long time. And I've been preaching over 34, 35 years. It's time for what you've been preaching, for it to be tested in you. And I'll tell you, it ain't no good feeling. Because, number one, because, you know, we're not used to this. We're being trained. The word of God is given to train us. We got to be taught how to live by faith. You know, it's hard to go out there and don't have a job and expect God to meet all your needs.
Right.
Somebody said, Victor, that don't make sense. God said, get a job. Well, I believe that. Amen. If you want a job, you go get one. I ain't gonna tell you not to. But I'm telling you, when you read this covenant, God's the promise to supply all your needs. You operate the way God tell you. I never tell nobody to quit your job. Walk out and quit your job. What I'm telling you is you be led by the Holy Spirit, because everybody ain't called to walk in the same direction. But one thing I do know is this, that these promises ain't based upon you going to get a 9-to-5. It ain't got nothing to do with it. All these blessings come by faith. Faith and obedience. Then the scripture says, if you're willing and obedient, you do what? You'll eat the good of the land. Then Paul said that my God shall what? Shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. So all of our blessings are supposed to come from God. I know God can give us a job. Everybody ain't going to walk at the same level. There's 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. Everybody not going to walk in the 100-fold blessing. Everybody don't want to. Some people enjoy being where they're at. You get a job and you work to pay your house off. You get a mortgage, which is killing you. You ain't gonna be able to pay it out to you in the grave, or somebody else pay it out. But God promised to give you houses and land, Marlene.
Amen.
What did he tell Peter in Mark 14? He told Peter came to Jesus, saying to him, he said, Lord, he said, Lord, we forsake all for you. We left our mothers, we left our brothers, we left our sisters, we left our house and land. Jesus looked at Peter and said, Peter, he said, there's no one that hath forsaken brothers, sisters, mothers for me, that in this life, I won't give it back to them with 100-fold, but I'm going to give it to them with persecution. Now, you don't get blessed, but persecution is coming with it. Let me tell you something. You think you're having a hard time now? Wait till God start blessing. People start judging. And it's the truth. You wait till you get a blessing. That's when you're going to see some envy. That's when you're going to see some jealousy. That's when you're going to see things come against you. So remember that when God blesses you, God said, hey, I'm going to give it to you. But persecution coming with it. Trials and tribulation coming with it. He said, if you forsake something, if you gave everything up for me, he said, I'm going to give it back to you. But I'm going to give it to you 100-fold. But I'm gonna, in this life. And he said, in this life. He didn't say, when you die and go to heaven, you don't need a house in heaven. You don't need a car in heaven. You don't need to be healed in heaven. You don't need peace in heaven. Because wherever God is, there's peace. That's why he called Jehovah Shalom. Every blessing of God is for now. Not the sweet by and by. Well, I can't wait till I get to heaven. You want to walk on the streets? No, it ain't going to do me no good to walk on something I can't use down here. People get so... I'm going to be brief, but I'm going to get on to what I'm talking about. People try to exit earth to get to heaven. Heaven ain't your home. Now looking at me like,
but then he taught me in church. Then what my tradition taught me, heaven is my home. Oh, girl, I can't wait till I die and go to heaven to be with the Lord.
Read your Bible. The Bible says Jesus is coming back to set his kingdom up on the earth, and we're going to rule with him for a thousand years here. Heaven ain't your. If heaven was your home, you wouldn't need to be on earth, would you?
Amen.
God would have gave you a body. He would have sent you to heaven as soon as he made you. He would have never put a guard to put Eve and Adam in it if he wanted them in heaven. God, you know, it's kind of like your mom, you know, when y'all, you know, when your kids get grown, you want, you, hey, you need to go get your own property. You need to get your own place. In other words, what, I ain't talking about you, okay? I'm just talking in general. I'm saying, it's the same way with God. God said, I don't want you up here. I want you here. This is where you're supposed to move. You don't need to be in my house. If I wanted you here, I would have kept you here. God put us up with the works of his hand. He put us in the earth to rule and to reign in the earth. He don't want us in heaven reigning.
Right.
Because if he did, he would have never created an earth for you to be in. And I don't know about y'all, but I want to be like Adam. That's why he came. Do y'all know? Read your Bible in Genesis. God came down to talk to Adam. If he wanted to talk to Adam in heaven, he would have put another chair there for Adam to sit next to him and talk to him. God wanted to talk with him while he was in the earth. That's why the Bible said in the cool of the day that God came down and he talked with it. He communed with it. Amen. Amen. In the cool of the day, in the afternoon, God came down to sit and talk to him. So we got to get our mind out of heaven into the earth. Because we got to work to do. Amen. We got to work to do. We got a covenant to manifest. People got to see the blessings of God in our lives. You know? And quit trying to exit the earth so quick. You know, I used to sing them songs. I don't sing them no more. Because God want to be in fellowship with us now.
Amen.
And I know y'all looking at me like, what are you talking about? But we got to quit being religious. And we got to start reading our Bible. You know, we got to read our Bible. We got to find out what belongs to us and what we're supposed to have. But anyway, I don't know why the Holy Spirit just drove me that way, because God want to be in fellowship. He want us to know, first of all, I want you to rule in the earth. I don't want you to live just to go to heaven. I want you to be in fellowship with me now. Please don't look forward to leaving the earth. Look forward to taking dominion and authority. Quit trying to exit. Quit giving up. Don't give up. Don't quit. You know? Why? Read your Bible. What the Bible say in Acts? It talk about how that when you receive the Holy Ghost, when you do what? You receive power. You receive dunamis, supernatural ability. Amen. God will give you his power, his enablement, that you'll be able to overcome whatever come against you in the earth. Amen. The Bible said God has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness in Christ Jesus. Everything we need, God has provided. Amen. Now, not when you get to heaven, right now. He has given you his power. So if I have God's power, supernatural ability, then guess what I can do? I can do like Elijah. I can call those things which be not as though they were. Yeah, I remember he shut the heavens up for 4.5 years. Said there would be no dew nor rain. And the Bible said the heavens were shut up. And then James said that Elijah was a man of life passion like us. He was weak like us. He was no greater than us. But he believed what he spoke, and God brought it to pass. Do you know you got to have faith? You got to believe? You got to have confidence? You got to know that when you speak the word of God, that first of all, God is obligated to his word. See, it's not your job to fulfill this. It's your job to believe it, and it's God's job through the Holy Spirit to fulfill it. If you will believe it, then God will fulfill his word. He'll bring his word to pass. So we got to believe it. We got to trust. We got to know that God's going to do what he promised. And we can't doubt. Because if you doubt, then you lose your right to possess what you're believing for. Because the Bible said, now faith is the title deed to what you believe in God for. So if you lose your faith, then you lose the right to have the promise. You know? It's just Just like if you come to my house and I got the deed to that house and you come on my property acting a fool, guess what? Amen. I'm going to call the police, and then the police don't come get you. Amen. Then I'm going to have to move you with a shotgun or with something else. Why? But because I got the title deed on it, and you don't have no right coming on my property if I own the deed. But if I don't have the deed to that property, now I'm not going to shoot nobody. But if I don't have the deed to that property, then I can't claim ownership. Right. Well, it's the same thing with the promises of God, that if I lose my faith, then I lose the right to have ownership or to possess the promises of God. So remember that. Hold on to your faith. Hold on to your confidence. Because if you lose that, see, David, that's why he fighting us so hard. Because he knows if I can steal your faith, then I can steal your right to possess or to receive what God has given you.
All right.
You know? So don't give up. Don't lose faith. Don't lose heart. Lord have mercy. It just seems like my goodness. So somebody lift your hands for me right quick. Let's worship the Lord. I feel it's like God trying to pull me in seven directions. And I'm trying to discern which way to go. You know, thank you, Lord. My goodness. Just worship the Lord for just one minute while I turn to the scriptures. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm telling you. Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 11. I don't know why I'm going this way, but God just shifted me, just totally shifted me somewhere. And we're going to just read out of this. Hebrews chapter 11, starting with verse 1. It said, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Now faith is. Somebody said, now faith.
Now faith.
Now faith.
Now faith.
Listen, you can't have faith for tomorrow. You can only have now faith. That's for now. Present tense, right now. Amen. Now faith. Listen to what he said. He said, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. What is faith? Let me define faith. Faith is trust. Faith is trust. Faith is assurance. They also use the word fidelity. To be faithful. Your faith and faithfulness go together pretty much. You know, how many of the Bible says that God is faithful to his word?
Right.
He's faithful. Mm-hmm. He's faithful. He's committed to his word. Faith is confidence. Faith is being persuaded. Faith is trustworthiness. Faith is relying on. Amen. Having assurance. Basically believing.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you say you have faith, you're saying, God, I trust you. God, I rely on you. God, I believe you. So, whatever God has promised you in his word, you got to have faith. You just have to trust. You have to believe. You have to have confidence that God is going to do what he said. You know, I preached a message years ago on the characteristics of faith. And one of the characteristics of faith is confidence. You know? Have you ever had somebody to question you and you know you was right? And it just makes you laugh to have to go prove to them to make them look like a fool. Because you knew you were so comfortable. I know that sounds rude, but it just you knew in yourself that you were right, and they just sitting there, you going, I'm telling you, and then you go open up and you show it to them, and they go, and they just lose all breath because you just put a blow on them, hit them in the chest, you know, and killed their pride, you know. But my point is this: that when you say you have faith, you have confidence, you know, you have an attitude that says, guess what? God said it, I believe it. Damn, I don't care how much you come against me, I'm confident that if God said it, he will do it. So can I not tell you, you got to walk around with confidence with your head in the air. Don't walk around like, oh, Lord, I'm broken. I don't know how I'm going to make. thank you, Lord. Lord, you got to walk around with confidence. You got to know that God is going to do what he said. Amen?
Amen.
You can't walk around in fear. You can't walk around in anxiety and stress. A lot of God's people walking around in anxiety, stress, and that comes from a spirit of fear. And the Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. We got to, amen. Most church folk are operating in fear. They're afraid. Anytime you're frustrated and full of anxiety, you know what I mean when I say frustrated and anxiety? You know when you want depression? Don't mess with me when I'm under pressure, because I get irritated quick. You know? I have to get somewhere and say, God, help me, strengthen me. Why? Because I'm under the pressures of life. Something is coming against me. And the evidence that you're not walking in faith is that you're under, when you're under pressure, you're easy to provoke. You're frustrated all day long. Why? Because you spend all day long, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I don't know how I'm going to make it. Why? Because you're trusting in your own human ability and you're not walking by faith. And anxiety is evidence that you're walking in fear. You know? So we shouldn't walk in fear. We shouldn't walk in anxiety. We shouldn't walk in stress. But we walk in faith. We walk in confidence. We know that our God, you know the Hebrew boys, y'all remember them, right? Amen. When Nebuchadnezzar threw them into the fire. You know, before he threw him in the fire, he said, whether my God deliver me or not, I'm not going to bow to you. You know? And when they trusted God, and when the Nebuchadnezzar threw him into the fire, the Bible said, and I'm paraphrasing, that there was a fourth man, Jesus, was walking in the fire with him. And they wasn't consumed. Can I tell you, if you'll keep faith and trust in God while you're in the midst of your fire, that Jesus will be in the midst of it with you, amen, the fire won't burn you, there won't be no smoke on you, amen, it won't even look like you, they won't know you've been to hell, amen, why? Because the fire won't be on you, the smoke won't be on you, amen, God will preserve you in the midst of what you're going through in your life, amen, but you got to keep confidence, you got to keep faith, you got to trust that he's going to bring you out.
Yes.
Amen.
And so, faith is having confidence.
Right.
You know? So I'm confident. I don't care what it looked like. God, you said. That's why I can get up and say, Lord, I praise you this morning.
Yes.
I'm not depressed. I'm not sad. I'm trusting you. And I don't walk by what I see, but I walk by faith. He said, the just shall live by faith.
Amen.
This is supposed to be a lifestyle. You know, if my job shut down tomorrow and said, Victor, we don't need you no more. We're firing. Are we closing down? I still got to trust that my God is going to survive.
Yes.
Because my trust is not in that job. My trust is in Jesus. And let me tell you, God can touch the heart of some. I met a preacher friend of mine that I know. This young guy, I don't really know him, but I met him some years ago. And we started talking and fellowshipping. And he said something to me that really blessed me. And it taught me something about faith. He stayed in Chicago. And he was telling me, he said, man of God, he said, I was going through a rough time, didn't have no food, didn't have no money. He said, I was walking. He said, somewhere in Chicago, he said, he didn't even worry, but he said, in Chicago, you're downtown walking. He said, I was hungry, didn't have no money, didn't know what I was going to do. He said, a man just stopped in front of me and looked at me and said, God said, give you this. He said, when I looked around, the man was gone. He said, and that blessed my spirit because that let me know that I don't care what life brings against you. If you trust God, God will make supernatural provision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Bible says you got to be careful who you entertain. Because sometimes you entertain angels unaware. I believe that God has sent his angels. Amen. An angel can be a person. Amen. I believe he can send an angel, but I believe he can send a person to bless you and help you out of what you're in. That's why you need to keep your confidence. You got to keep faith because, amen, faith will cause God to come in. Oh, man, so many different avenues. You won't know where he's coming. You'll be surprised. He'll call people to bless you that don't even like you. That's what I like. I like when he made folks that don't like me bless me. I remember one time God made a man that I know didn't like me bless me. He made him buy me a brand new motor for my car. Sure did. Amen. I ministered to him and he ended up blessing me. And I knew that he didn't like me because somebody told me that. But God said, God had me to go minister to him. And he ended up blessing me. Can I tell you, if you'll keep faith and confidence and stay in a place where God can use you, God will cause people to bless you, to sow into your life. But you gotta hold on to your faith. You can't give up. So faith is having confidence. Faith is believing. Faith is trusting. It comes from the Greek word pistis. It's spelled P-I-S-T-I-S. Amen. It just means to have confidence. To rely on, to trust in. So remember, church, don't give up, man. Amen. If you'll keep your faith, God bless you. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Now faith is the substance. Faith is the substance of what you're believing God for. Now faith is the substance. It's the substance. It's the evidence of what you're believing God for. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. I really don't want to get into that because we can go somewhere else on that, but I'm going to keep it simple. Amen. So we understand that the worlds were framed, were shaped. How many know that God spoke the worlds into existence by his word? And then the Hebrew writer, they said Paul wrote the book of Hebrew, but they tried to say Mark did too and a couple more. But Mark even said that Hebrew said that God uphold all things by the power of his word. How many know that if God removed his word, that this whole world would be destroyed? Because everything is upheld by his word. And how do you know that means this in the simplest term, that even your life is upheld by his word. Yes, yes, yes. All God got to do is speak a word and we'll lay down and die.
Yeah.
Because all things are upheld by his word. Mm-hmm. You know? So we got to, that's why I'm trying to tell you today, that's why we got to keep trust in his word. Because the Bible said heaven and earth will pass away with what? His word is going to last forever.
Yeah.
It'll never fail. Yeah. It'll never pass away. So if we'll keep faith in that word and have faith, faith is what caused that word to become alive.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. You know? That's why the Bible said what? The letter kill it, but the spirit make it alive. So, without the spirit of God and without faith, then this word is just dead. It won't produce nothing. It won't do nothing. Somebody said, well, I speak the word every day. But do you believe it? Do you have an expectation? Are you looking forward to God doing something for you? Or are you just speaking it and go through your day all day long with no expectation?